operated on. He was faced with hollering and screaming, pulling out IVs, taking too much narcotics. So I said, I'm not on staff at that hospital. And he said, well, you'll be on staff in 30 minutes. Get over here. So looked at the situation, and somehow, and this was, I was fresh out of residency, and he said, and I said, well, you're taking a lot of narcotics, and you're having a lot of pain, so therefore, I thought he was addicted, but I knew that he wasn't going to take a diagnosis of addiction at that point in time, so I somehow came up with, I think the side effects of your medicine are outweighing the benefits. You're telling me you're taking all this medicine, well, if this is the right medicine for you, then your pain should be a two. And the patient said, I never thought of it that way, but you're right. So I said, well, we got to find another regimen that works better for you. I said, and second thing is we got to get you doing the right things physically and not doing the wrong things physically according to your particular anatomy, your particular bones and discs and joints. And one of the things that had come out in the history is that he was always doing things for his work and for his family that were damaging his body. So he was taking narcotic pain medication so that he could do these physical activities to be a good parent and to keep his job. But he kept doing this, and so now he's having his third surgery because he keeps damaging the same area of his body. So the underlying cause of his pain keeps getting worse because of his own decisions and his own actions. So then I said, well, in stress management, lifestyle adjustment, we've got to help you figure out how can you be a good parent? How can you be a good enough spouse? How can you make money? How can you have fun, your social and leisure activities, without damaging your body? And he said, I don't know how to do those things at the same time. If I'm taking care of myself physically, then I'm not being a good parent or a good spouse. And I'm not going hunting and fishing with my buddies. If I am doing the things that I want or need to do in those roles as parent, spouse, social, leisure, then I'm in bed for 3 days. So if you can help me figure out how to be a good parent, how to earn a living, and how to enjoy my life without damaging my body, that would be great. So the model hasn't changed since then. And we'll go into some of the details. Obviously, a lot of the details have been updated and filled out and changed to be more effective. But that basic framework of let's make sure we understand exactly what physical activity is healthy, that is, the more you do it, the better you get. And what physical activity is unhealthy, that is, the more you do it, the worse you get. Let's get you on non-habit-forming medication that treats the underlying cause of your pain, as well as your mood, anxiety, and sleep disorder symptoms. And let's gradually, safely, and with a minimum of discomfort, get you off of all habit-forming medications because they're not working. If they were working, you wouldn't be here. So, of course, we don't get to treat people with chronic pain, mood, anxiety, and sleep disorders at our place and addiction. We only get to treat people with treatment-resistant mood, anxiety, and sleep disorders, as I'm sure in your office. The easy ones get better without seeing us. It's only the most difficult cases, the most treatment-resistant cases. I say only. That's a little bit of an exaggeration. Sometimes we get some of the easy ones. But I'm sure in your practice as well, you find that somehow the people that you wind up seeing are the people who are not getting better, which takes a lot of the fun out of being a healthcare practitioner, because we like to help people get better. So the problem is the people that get better go away, and the people who don't get better keep coming to our offices. And this is for physicians and nurses, as well as psychiatrists, psychologists, and social workers. So this is a kind of a basic diagram of how this happens. Let's say that a person stubs their toe. There's an inflammation process that occurs there, and that inflammation is converted into a nerve impulse. And there's a nerve that goes from your toe up to your spinal cord and then up to your brain, descending pathway kind of turns down the volume on the severity of the pain impulse that's being transmitted to the brain. And so if you just stub your toe, then and you don't do anything, that pain will eventually go away. The system will react to that and deal with it. The problem comes with chronic pain. So now let's say you've got arthritis in your toe. And that, so that change in the joint structure is not going away. And so it keeps stimulating this nerve. That nerve. And that nerve keeps firing. Pain, 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 over and over again. And what happens is that system, that whole system, that whole system, both on the way up and on the way down, gets worn out. Just like you get stressed out, burned out, and, you know, you're kind of overloaded, and you physically get very fatigued, and decreased energy, decreased concentration, because you're burning the candle at both ends. This nerve pathway that is transmitting this pain is working overtime. And as that continues to work overtime, it becomes biologically depleted of neurotransmitters that transmit the pain. And also, you've heard of the gait control theory, maybe. Some people have heard of that. That's where the gait is. This is the gate that closes when this is able to shut down that impulse. And this is what gets worn out. And this is where some medications work that get it better. Now, let's think about something that we have. Oh, yeah, please.
Can we ask questions?
Sure.
Is it possible to cut a nerve and as a way to prevent pain?
With rare exception, when you cut a nerve, pain gets worse. Which brings me to my next story. Think about everybody's heard of phantom limb pain, right? Phantom limb pain. So a person has lost their leg, and you see them, and they tell you that even though they've lost their leg, they can still feel their toes. Right? Everybody knows that?
Yeah.
So think about that for a minute. What that says is that the pain is actually living in this nerve, so that even without the toe being there, the person can feel pain in their toe. So hold that thought for a minute. Now let's think about something else. You see someone who's had a spinal cord injury, and they say they can't feel anything below the waist. So So, if these nerves are cut, you can hit the toe with a hammer. The sensation, if these are severed, the person doesn't feel pain. So if you put those two things together, A, chronic pain lives in the nerve. It may start in the toe, but it actually lives in the nerve. And that's why some people with arthritis get disappointed that the anti-inflammatory medications aren't working for their pain anymore. It's like, wait, I have arthritis, these reduce inflammation, but my pain is not going away. So my answer to that is, well, because of how long you've had this, the pain is now living in that nerve that transmits the pain. If you put that together with the second example, what that means is that this whole pathway is involved. That without the brain, you don't feel pain. So the pain is living in the nerve, traveling to the brain. If it doesn't get to the brain, you don't feel it. Impulse from the brain comes back down. So the idea that the pain lives in the central nervous system, well, that's what we treat. And the psychotherapy that you do influences the biology of the brain. And that's why psychotherapy, and obviously we'll get into it, behavioral techniques, so on and so forth, have been shown in the scientific literature to reduce physical pain. Now, you can't say this to a patient in the very beginning because it doesn't make any sense to them. But we'll get into how to approach patients and stuff. But I just think these are things you already know. You already know about phantom limb pain. You already know that people with a spinal cord injury. But this is somehow the action that happens there winds up reducing the sensitivity to that nerve. It's kind of counterintuitive, but it actually does. Yes?
And will you touch on people's ability, the difference, different people, different abilities to handle pain?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, and back when you're talking about how that pathway gets burned out.
Yes.
I mean, to me, it sounds like burnout is where and how it wouldn't be as effective anymore. But it's still, so what does it mean burned out?
Well, we're going to get to that.
Okay.
But the short answer is, just like in mood disorders and anxiety disorders, when these nerves fire, they release neurotransmitters. What I call hormones that are in the brain and spinal cord, that's what a neurotransmitter is. If these nerves are firing, pain, 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 just like if there's stress, 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 the areas that are involved with that can't make enough neurotransmitter to keep up with the demand. As those neurotransmitters go down, if it's a pain pathway, pain gets worse. If it's the mood, anxiety, sleep disorders pathway, then mood, anxiety, and sleep disorder symptoms get worse. So that's why the medications that block the breakdown of these naturally occurring hormones, as those hormones start to go back up, you get relief from mood, anxiety, and sleep disorders. But because some of those same hormones are in the pain pathways, same hormone, different location, that's why Cymbalta works for, has an FDA approval for chronic pain, mood, and anxiety disorders. All three. Effective for all three. It's not that the depression is causing the pain, although it certainly can amplify it, but the same hormones are in those. And I was taught as a resident, I saw a paper that Elavil, amitriptyline, one of the oldest so-called antidepressants, even back in the 80s, it was known that that worked for chronic pain. And it wasn't understood why, and it particularly wasn't understood why it worked for pain at a lower dose than it worked for depression. But those were one of some of the early indications that there was something that pain and depression had in common. They weren't the same thing, because if the person had depression, they needed a much higher dose to get relief. But somehow, physical pain was getting better on a relatively low dose of this so-called antidepressant. And it didn't take long to figure that out. So, the pain pathways go to these two major brain areas. The somatosensory cortex is kind of between the frontal lobe and the back of the brain. It's this strip here. And that basically locates the position of where this is coming from. For you, this is the important part and the exciting part. You might have heard of the limbic system. The limbic system makes the decision, eat it, fight it, or bake with it. That's a basic core brain system. It's present in reptiles. That's the first time you see it. Not just mammals, reptiles. We're going down in the phylogenetic spectrum. So, now let me just point something else out about the slide. This is the American Academy of Pain Medicine Chronic Pain Treatment Guidelines. So, this is not coming from psychiatrists, psychologists, and social workers. This is coming from Chronic Pain Medical Treatment Guidelines, published in 2009. So, and we're going to get into this a little bit more. So the point of this is that it is now recognized by all of the official pain organizations and pain researchers that past memories, environmental factors, internal cognitive factors, psychosocial issues influence and modulate the pain experience. And how the brain integrates all of this and put in part is the basic for the biopsychosocial approach to the management of pain. So the pain organizations are now saying that for chronic pain, only a biopsychosocial approach will be effective. This is the big framework that I talked about, just to give you kind of an overview, and then we're going to get into a few more details about this. I tell physical therapists in our we have physical therapists on staff here, and we have four exercise physiologists on staff full time. And I tell them that their job is to teach a person a regimen that they can do themselves when they leave here. So traditionally, treatment, medical treatment, or physical therapy being one type of medical treatment, this is something someone does to you. I'm going to prescribe you a pill. That treatment, you take the pill. There's nothing else that you really have to do. The pill is the treatment. Or if you go to physical therapy, they do things to you. What we're focused on is we want to get people to the point where they can do this for themselves at home. So it's referred to as a home exercise program in the literature that these organizations put out. But it's basically, what are the physical activities that the more you do them, the better you get? We need to identify those and facilitate your ability to do those without a therapist. And what are the ones that do damage to your body? We need to understand those. And that's where the psychosocial part comes in part, is to say, well, how can you have a fulfillment as a parent, as a spouse, social, occupational leisure, without doing those physical activities that damage your body? And that's very often much of the psychotherapy revolves around that. So we have these different types of medications. The anti-inflammatories like ibuprofen and naproxen, and there's many more, aspirin and Tylenol. Then you have the so-called antidepressants that work in both the serotonin and norepinephrine systems. Serotonin and norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors. Cymbalta, Effexor, and the old tricyclics like Elavil. Then we have, I'm sure most people have heard of Neurontin, Gabapentin, Pregabalin, Lyrica. These are nerve cell membrane stabilizers. So if nerve cells are like electric wires, these kind of reinforce the insulation and slow down the firing rate. Then we have muscle relaxants like Baclofen, Flexeril, Xanaflex, Robaxin, which are non-habit-forming and relax muscles. And then we have things like lidocaine patches, local anesthetics that are topical. Stress management, lifestyle adjustment, cognitive behavioral therapy, counseling and relaxation techniques. These are available free, low cost to the patient, community-based. I haven't pointed out one of the most important aspects of this slide, which is, this is from the Centers for Disease Control. So they put out some guidelines of prescribing opiates for chronic pain in April of 2016. And they basically said, you got to be careful about prescribing opiates for long-term pain. Need to minimize the dose. Try to get them off of it as soon as possible. How do you do that? This is how you do that. These are the treatment modalities you want to emphasize beyond opiates. And of course, my response to this was, good, the things I've been doing are right. You know, it's always nice if you're doing something and it's working. It's always nice to see some published article that says that it works.
Which is wonderful, but it takes so much more time than just writing prescriptions.
Right? I'm sorry, it takes so much more time
than in terms of physician time. Writing a prescription is so much easier.
Yes,
right?
Yes, you are correct.
Really how we
and
in this test.
And I think the chronic pain is a chronic disease. And so if we look at, I think diabetes always holds up well as an analogy, where if a person has diabetes, if they just have healthy diet and healthy exercise, then they won't need medication, right? Well, for some types of diabetes, that's true. It's mild. That's indispensable, and medical in the larger sense of indispensable. addictive substances, when they're taken on a regular basis for a long time, actually make pain worse. And that doesn't make any sense until they get off of them and they feel better, to which they say, this doesn't make any sense. That I was taking all this pain medicine before, and I was still having a lot of pain. Obviously, when I swallowed it, I got a little relief for a little while. Now you've got me completely off the pain medicine, and I don't have any pain. So, obviously, we can talk about the mechanisms for this, but, you know, I went into medicine partly because I didn't want to be in sales. But when you tell a patient that they're going to have less pain off of opiates than on opiates, you're in sales. Particular pain condition. understands the big picture, then they can say, here's what we're doing, this is important, here's how it fits into the bigger picture, here's the other things that are important. And when patients hear this, they go, oh, now I understand why the other stuff didn't work. Now, you know, before they went to their surgeon, and their surgeon said, I can't find anything wrong with you, translation, I can't find anything to operate on.
Right.
And the patient goes, well, what are you talking about? I'm hurt, there's something wrong. And the surgeon, instead of saying, well, you need non-surgical treatment, some of the surgeons will say, there's nothing wrong with you if there's nothing for me to operate on. So, and I try to educate surgeons when I speak with them, just to say, you know, the thing to do is just let them know they have something real, they need treatment, but just not surgical treatment at this time. Let me run through a few more slides, and then, because I think I'm going to answer a lot of questions, and then we'll take a break. So, again, the American Academy of Pain Medicine Chronic Pain Treatment Guidelines, it recognizes that traditionally the biomedical model, you stub your toe hurts, therefore we need to give you medicine that reduces the inflammation in your toe, and you are cured. Well, that works for infection, but it doesn't work for chronic disease. It's now understood that biomedical model alone is incomplete. And so, the biopsychosocial model, again, this is coming from the pain organization, Chronic Pain Medical Treatment Guidelines, American Academy of Pain Medicine, is ultimately, again, this whole complex, which you already know. And so this is the difference in the biomedical and the biopsychosocial model. Works well for acute pain, biopsychosocial for chronic. Emphasizes what's going on in your toe, peripheral nociception. Biopsychosocial recognizes the role that central mechanisms, meaning the brain and spinal cord, play in modulating peripheral nociception, noci being pain, inception being perception, recognition by the system. Focus on physical disease, defense mechanisms acutely. When we get into chronic pain, people have used the term chronic pain syndrome, where there's this whole question of pain-related behaviors and what's the interaction between thoughts, emotions, judgment, decision-making, and behaviors, and physical pain, and we'll get into that a little bit more. Your pain is in your toe. You need a physical toe treatment. No, we need to treat the whole system. And taking a pill for your toe pain because you stubbed it, that's simple medical management. Any kind of chronic disease, you need active involvement of the person in doing the physical and biological lifestyle changes and psychosocial lifestyle changes that have an impact. So, again, the American Academy of Pain Medicine is saying, well, we need to know their past histories and confounding psychosocial variables like history of emotional trauma, anxiety, mood, fear-based anxiety avoidance, catastrophizing, which we'll get into, self-medication with habit-forming medications or substances, and psychosocial factors, external stressors, which have an impact on judgment and decision-making and stress. So, you think orthopedic surgeons are going to do this?
No.
You think primary care physicians are going to do this, or nurse practitioners? Probably. That's why a social worker for chronic pain, why a psychologist for chronic pain, why a psychiatrist for chronic pain, is because if these issues are not addressed, then the patient with chronic pain doesn't get better, because if these didn't need to be addressed, they'd already be better.
Right.
They wouldn't have the pain anymore.
Right.
So again, the concept that the people who get better go away, we don't get to see them. We only get to see the people who don't get better after they've tried other things. Sir William Olsler was a physician physician at Johns Hopkins, a well-liked teacher, researcher, and clinician around the turn of the century, and where I trained and at Mass General, everybody likes to do an Holzler quote because he has a lot to say about the doctor-patient relationship. So this is one of my quotes that I had left over, and I thought it was appropriate. Holzler, as an internist, as a medical doctor, not a psychiatrist, recognized a long time ago that you not only have to know what illness the person has, you have to know what kind of person has the illness. And an example of that is with these knee pain conditions. Well, if you're a therapist working in an office, that's different than if you are a construction worker. Same knee injury. But that knee injury has a completely different significance if the way you make your living depends on your body. And it's going to make a difference in how you react to that physical pain and physical limitations. And it's going to make a difference on how you comply with treatment. And it's going to make a difference in the stress-related components of how much anxiety, worry, stress is going to amplify the pain. By the way, we say chronic pain, and I'm saying chronic pain, but you need to, the sort of thing that goes along with chronic pain is physical limitations. And the physical limitations are just as important part of this as the pain sensation. So it's not just about the sensation of pain. It's about, I can't do what I want or need to do physically. So that even if their pain goes away, if they're still limited physically in what they're able to do, problem hasn't been solved. But another way, all of the pain guidelines emphasize that the purpose of treating pain is to improve function. So reducing pain is only half of it. It's improving physical and, more importantly, psychosocial functioning. That's the issue. And a lot of times people may not be able to get fully functional physically, but psychosocial, they can have great recovery.
So, Doc, in a previous lecture here, I heard that when you take anxiety medicine, the system says, hey, I'm not getting sensory input from this fire, so let's turn up the sensitivity. Is that a similar thing? Will we come to that in this discussion?
Well, I would say anxiety medicine is an imprecise term.
Okay.
The reason is because if we're talking about habit-forming anxiety medicine like Valium, that takes the place of the naturally occurring hormone, and in that system, like the opiates, the more you take, the more the system acclimates to it. It grows more receptors and becomes more sensitive to it. If we're talking about using a serotonin reuptake inhibitor like paroxetine, Paxil, fluoxetine, Prozac, citalopram, Celexa, escitalopram, Lexapro, sertraline, Zoloft, those are all approved for anxiety. They block the breakdown of naturally occurring serotonin, and when that goes up, the receptors actually get back to normal in number and sensitivity. When those go down, the receptors go up in number and sensitivity. So those systems work very differently, and what you're saying is true for the habit-forming medications. So, and that's sometimes with patients that say, well, I've tried medication before. Well, my first question is, what did you take? What was good about it? What was bad about it? And a lot of times is they were on the wrong medicine. And so it's not that medicine doesn't work. It's that the medicine you've tried hasn't worked for you. We need to learn from that and look at what other treatments can do the good things and not do the bad things. It's all about benefit and side effects. That for the long term. So it's not just about some medications work well in the short term, the narcotic pain medications. They work great in the short term, but if you continue to take them, the benefits decrease and the side effects increase, just like Valium and Xanax for anxiety. With the non-habit-forming medications, exactly depressive disorder, I'm sure everybody's familiar, and the mnemonic SIG ECAPs, one of them. Anyway, SIG is which what we write on a prescription when we say, these are the directions. SIG, and ECAPs is energy caps. But anyway, sleep, interest, guilt, or depression, feeling helpless, hopeless, worthless, decrease energy, decrease concentration, appetite changes, psychomotor changes, slowing or agitation, suicidal thoughts. Well, guess what? So depression can also cause physical symptoms. About a third of people with depression get all kinds of physical aches or pains that are inadequately accounted for. Pain conditions, being in chronic pain, can cause all of these symptoms. If you're not, if you don't have major depressive disorder and you have pain that doesn't go away, all of these things begin to become affected. And basically, this is what we've been saying: alterations in mood and anxiety state amplify pain perception and expression. This is something called catastrophizing, where it's almost like a hypochondriacal thing, where people are, my pain is not going away. This is horrible. This is going to kill me. And it's like, well, you have arthritis in your knee. It's not life-threatening. We can treat it, but it's not healthy for you to focus on your knee pain all day long. And so sometimes this is in the pain literature, that if a person is catastrophizing, they can't get their mind off the negatives, they keep focusing on the negatives of the present and all the negatives that they expect to happen in the future, that is a negative prognostic indicator. They don't get better physically once they get stuck in that, unless you treat that. So that's a term that's in the pain literature, and again, it's another example of how the pain community is recognizing the importance of.
That is very interesting information. I've been a nurse for 30 years, and over the course of time, from the beginning of my practice, I remember seeing pain as a helpful symptom. It was something that sort of gave us an
impression. Say signal.
Yeah, it's a
yes.
Signal. What's wrong with the body?
Yes.
Body, mind, or spirit? Something's out of whack. Let's go ahead and dig and get to root causes and find out what's going on.
Yes.
Take care of it once and for all. It's very sad over the course of all this time that we have somehow forgotten that. And instead of seeing pain as our ally, it appears as though we see pain as our enemy. And which I think ends up with
complete is going to be the response to non-medication techniques alone. So the idea that can be the cure for everyone, I can say that can be a useful tool for everyone, but that might not be adequate for those who have the long-term pain generator that doesn't stop generating pain even when there's no acute danger. So the idea is to identify healthy physical activity, healthy biological interventions, which by some of the time. But when we talk about it as an issue, we're really talking about it where it's gotten to the severity where it's an obstacle and it's a contributor to the problem.
And so the doctor would be the one to say, no, you shouldn't be smoking.
Yeah, well, I think that's where, you know, people benefit from guidance. So sometimes they'll say, you know, people with chronic pain will say, well, it hurts to do everything, so either I do nothing or I do everything. It's going to hurt anyway, so I just go do what I want to do, and then I'm in bed for 3 days. So what we do with accurate physical diagnosis and accurate physical treatment plan and sending someone to a physical therapist or exercise physiologist is, if you focus on these physical activities, it may hurt in the beginning, but you'll get better. These physical activities will damage the underlying cause of the pain. So the underlying cause of your pain, your joint damage, will get worse. So now that we've given them some guidance, if they will follow that guidance, they get better. So that's part of this is counterintuitive, and for the people who aren't getting better, that's, you know, why have they not figured out how to get better? Why have they not found the right doctor or the right treatment? That's what they need us for. They need us to do a good assessment and to figure out what kind of intervention specifically, or combination of interventions, will help them to feel better, to function better, to help them to accomplish what they want to accomplish in a healthy way. And so sometimes people say, well, are you telling me I can't do this? And I say, you can do whatever you want to. But what I'm telling you is that if you're going to do these unhealthy physical activities and you expect to get better, I don't expect those two things to go together. So you can do whatever you want to. You know, if you want to try what I'm suggesting and it doesn't work, then we'll go to plan B. But if you want to keep doing what you've been doing, don't expect to get a different result. So that's where I do the adult to adult thing, the respect thing. I'm not going to say, you have to do this. Okay, I'll do this. Okay, last one, and then we'll take a break.
And if you're in the throes of addiction and doctor shopping, you're not going to listen, really. You know, you're going to keep going for the oxys or roxys or, you know, et cetera, et cetera.
Well, and you're bringing up something that reminds me of an important point. Not everyone is an addict. So there are people who have been taking 3 or 4 pain pills a day for years. They've been taking it exactly as prescribed. The benefits are outweighing the side effects, or maybe they're not outweighing the side effects. But they don't have the other addictive behaviors, which we'll get into. Addictive behaviors and the types of behaviors in pain patients that indicate that they may have an addiction problem. Long-term narcotic pain medication treatment is still a legitimate option. It should be chosen and done very carefully. But just like alcohol, you know, you can think of this like alcohol is what it helps people to relate to it. Well, some people become alcoholics, so alcohol should be banned, right? Nobody should be able to drink alcohol. Again, just to say,
prior lecture, the same thing. It said to the patient, how did you like the pain, narcotic pain medication? One patient says, I hated it, made me sick, I was nauseous. The other guy was like, I loved it, gave me energy. Well, it was the addict.
And so they felt better emotionally as well as physically. Yeah, we'll get into that.
I have two comments to make before everyone, I'm going to take some of your bathroom time, sorry. Bob's question sort of underscored for me that I didn't do a very good job telling you what I do here. So I just want to say that real quickly. I am the outreach coordinator, kind of client services, so I'm a liaison between the community and our staff here. Could be a clinician, like there's a couple people in here who have a patient in the facility right now. And if you ever need to get a message to someone, or you're not getting a call back that you thought you should get, you could call me. And also, if you have a client in your practice and you're concerned about them and you're not sure whether they need to be referred up to the residential level of care, I'm your girl to call. And I'm a resource. I've been in this community for years. So it could be that your client is not an appropriate patient for Lakeview, but I will help you, right, Nan and Val? I will help you find the right place, or if it's sex addiction or, you know, something like that. Like, we are a community, a wonderful collaborative community, and I can help plug you in to the right place. So that's one thing. Thank you. And the other is, if there's someone here who's never had the tour of Lakeview, I will hang around after Dr. Blotner's finished, and I'd be happy to walk you around and give you the VIP tour. Okay.
What do I have to do today? Right. Okay, I'm supposed to go to that doctor.
again, it's psychosocial factors, including how much trauma they had in the past, the age of the combat exposure, other psychosocial factors outside of. Actually, I saw an interesting talk once by, I'm forgetting the guy's name, I don't know if you remember, a long time ago, like maybe in the 90s, it was a U.S. pilot shot down over Bosnia, and he survived for 6 days, and then he was picked up and brought home. I don't know if you, anyway, he was a pilot shot down, American pilot shot down, survived for 6 days, and then was rescued. So he spoke. I saw him speaking at a conference. And someone asked him, did you get post-traumatic stress disorder? He said, no. And so the person said, do you have any idea why not? And he said, well, he said, I've thought about this some, and in the military, you know, when you come back after a battle, there's a, or incident or whatever, there's a debriefing. There's a, you immediately are surrounded by people who are supportive and interested in helping you to get back to your prior level of functioning. They're very interested in what your experience was. You're certainly not blamed for it, or you're not made to feel ashamed of it, or like it was your fault. There's a whole support system there after you've been through something traumatic in the military. And he said, I've wondered about, with PTSD in civilian life, whether if there was more of that there, if there was more support and non-judgmental attitudes about whatever the trauma was about, and if it happened early, because this happens immediately after they come back from the experience, whether that might prevent post-traumatic stress disorder symptoms in a lot of people. So I just thought, a story came to mind, I thought I'd throw that out. That is, yes?
Do you have any idea whether there's less PTSD with current military because of what you just described as compared to
I really don't know anything about statistics and, you know, and obviously if you get into the details of the types of trauma in the military and the social and cultural milieu for, you know, in the past as opposed to, you know, that's a whole thing. But you get the idea. So, once again, with chronic pain, people get these symptoms even if they don't have a diagnosable condition. And so, I think it's especially important that we watch out that these, symptoms don't snowball and become a full-blown diagnosis, which obviously happens frequently. This is just sort of a model of chronic pain and PTSD interactions and things they have in common that have been postulated. And there are several models like this. I just thought this one kind of separated out. One thing I noticed, chronic pelvic pain in women that I had seen in the hospital, so before I'd done a lot of med-surg consults, and one of the things at some point I figured out was that the pelvic pain could potentially be a trauma trigger. And if this is a trauma trigger, then they've got this loop of pain and the emotional reaction as a trauma trigger. And so I decided I would treat everyone as if they had post-traumatic stress disorder and started having much more treatment success. And I didn't say to them, you have trauma, but just the idea of this is emotionally traumatic, having this pain, when your pain acts up, it reminds you of your painful episodes from the past. You know, medication-wise, I treated them as if they had post-traumatic stress disorder. if they are starting to gain weight, I'll push the norepinephrine component and decrease the serotonin component.
We need you.
I mean, Wellbutrin or bupropion is the one that's all norepinephrine and dopamine, no serotonin. And at Mass General, at least years ago, that was the most frequently used add-on to a serotonin agent. Paxil, Prozac, Zoloft, Celexa, Lexapro. And that you could, that way you could balance the one that's serotonin only and the one that's... If you get the norepinephrine agent without the serotonin agent, if there's any anxiety that's significant, the anxiety goes up. So if someone's thinking about it, they could potentially do it. There's no reason why a primary care physician couldn't do this. Obviously, any psychiatrist can do it, often does. But people just don't think about it and approach it that way. They say, oh, you didn't get these two things in one pill, so I'll just give you the one pill. And that may be good for some people. But for other people, if I'm really concerned about the amount of emotional suffering that they're going through, and I want to have that flexibility.
It's that chronic health thing that made me ask the question. I have so many women with that issue.
Yes.
I have a physical therapist that was in town, was a specialist, and she and I work together a lot.
Yes. Yes. It can be a very it can be a very stubborn problem. And I think all you need is someone who's competent in prescribing medications who you can talk to about the perspective. And if you have one particular psychiatrist and you say, you know, I think with the physical pain and the emotional suffering, if they could be adequately covered safely and adequately covered by effective medication that works in the SNRIs, is what you've heard of or read about, that you think that could be an important part of the solution, and that what you're going to be able to do with them is going to be limited if that's not optimized. And you may be able to get someone who said, oh yeah, I can do that. You know, they may not think about it that way, but now that they started thinking about it that way, they go, oh yeah, we can.
Tell me my language again, what I want to say.
Well, you've read that the SNRIs, mm-hmm. serotonin, norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors, are effective for chronic pain as well as mood and anxiety problems.
Okay.
And your concern is that they get a trial from somebody who is not afraid to get to the dose that's going to work for them.
Okay.
And because you see a lot of people who are on low doses and the low doses are not working. And you heard some weird psychiatrist talking to Jackson. Yes. And by the way, the thought of a trial.
That you gave me the keyword. Yes.
And ultimately, this would, if you don't think it's the right treatment, that's fine.
Right. You gave me the right word. Thank you.
I'm bringing up a question about a trial. I'm not advocating that this is what this person must have.
Yeah.
I'm not telling you what to do.
Yeah.
And if you say I don't think that's appropriate for them, I will say fine. I will never disagree with you about that.
Yes, I'm with you. Thank you.
Yes.
I'm a medical assistant at Mayo Clinic in gynecology, and we actually refer patients to physical therapy, but we've also, our physicians have started using compounded vaginal diazepam for their pelvic pain.
Yes.
So.
Yeah, there are all kinds of possibilities out there. So let's see. So again, avoidance, fatigue, lethargy, depression, generalized anxiety. Again, you can see the overlap. In pain treatment, this is what pain practitioners are taught to do. This is by a guy named Stephen Hassick, who's a psychologist who's been doing chronic pain and addiction work for a long time. This is sort of a standard thing. The four A's, analgesia, pain relief, ADLs. We want to know not only how are you feeling, but how's your functioning doing since we made the last treatment change. Adverse effects. saying this is what is legitimate narcotic treatment for pain. This is what needs to be followed in order for that to be safe and effective. And that includes the psychosocial factors. And this is what addiction is, and this is what requires addiction treatment. Those three organizations came up with one document.
What is photophobia?
Sensitivity to light. So here's a contemporary definition of addiction. And so in this context, I'm suggesting addiction is an adverse effect. Addiction is, and this comes from that document, that pain and addiction organizations have agreed on. There are genetic components to addiction, there are psychosocial components to addiction, and there are environmental factors that influence development and manifestations. So people can walk around with the genetic component. Maybe they've stayed away from alcohol because they've seen an alcoholic in the family. And then somebody puts them on pain medicine when they're 40 years old and they become they develop addiction behavior for the first time that they've never had before. So that would be an environmental factor, that is a biological environmental factor. Environment of their bloodstream was introduced, and even though the genetic factor was there before, without the environmental factor being introduced, they didn't manifest addiction behavior. So, like our earlier example with alcohol, this is not a predictable drug effect. It's an idiosyncratic adverse reaction in vulnerable individuals. So again, not everyone is an addict. But if someone responds like an addict, then they need to be treated for addiction. Impaired control over use, compulsive use, craving, continued use despite harm, we know that. Aberrant behavior is a concept that's come up in the pain literature about indicators of opiate side effects that may be indicators of addiction. So these are referred to as aberrant behaviors, one of the four A's. Impaired coping with stress, impaired judgment and decision making, tensions in family relationships, legal, economic, social consequences, and of course this is based on behavior patterns over time. So, I'm imagining some of you may occasionally see somebody who's on narcotic pain medication. If you see these things getting worse, I would ask, when is the last time that your narcotic pain medication dose was changed? When is the last time you started taking more? If you have a question about whether these behaviors have gotten worse and they are taking a narcotic pain medication, I would pick up the phone and call the person prescribing the narcotic pain medication. And I would say, I'm following this person and I'm noticing these symptoms and behaviors are getting worse. I just want to alert you to that. They also mentioned that these had increased since their last medication dosage change, and I just want to alert you to it. I don't know. I think that's okay. I think most people would say, thanks for calling. I don't want them out there with this happening and me not know about it. So I'm not going to take that as you're telling me how to prescribe medicine. I'm taking that you're doing me a favor and letting me know there's a problem that I'd rather know that it's there and deal with it than not know that it's there. And again, you say, I just want to give you the information. Whatever you think is appropriate is fine. I'm not trying to tell you how to prescribe. I just want you to have the information.
What about people on the maintenance of oxycodone? I mean, can they have some of these side effects pop up too?
Well, people on Suboxone and methadone can get side effects. I think that maintenance treatment is sort of, from our point of view, there's a group of patients that are better having maintenance treatment than no treatment at all. From our point of view, when we get somebody here with the intensity of the treatment that we do, people don't need maintenance treatment when they leave here. And we don't do maintenance treatment here. Okay? In the real world, not everybody has access to this. You know, we have a facility that has no locked doors. We don't take Baker Acts. We don't have Medicare or Medicaid here. It feels like a three-star hotel. We do the physical. Everybody goes to the gym every day. And if they have physical therapy, they'll get physical therapy every day. Not everybody has access to that. And so for those who are not able to get the full treatment that they need, sometimes maintenance treatment is better than either no opiate or some other opiate. So when I was at the University of Florida as head of the pain clinic there, which I did for a couple of years before I came here, we had people with addiction and chronic pain, and methadone and buprenorphine or Suboxone we used in them, and we're doing urine drug screens, monitoring carefully for side effects, making sure they're in a recovery program, that worked for them better than what they were doing before they got to us. And these were people that couldn't do this. That may be more details than you need. But, yeah.
Well, I just seen some of that, you know, like Suboxone, you know, they take it because they think it's
better.
And you really,
a stable dose of Suboxone is better than heroin. So the expression I came came out with was, well, you got the dark cloud part, you deserve all the silver lining you can get. And so he said, yeah, you know, just I used to go hunting and fishing with my buddies. I can't do that anymore, but whenever somebody had a problem with their gun, I was always the one that fixed the gun, so now I've got a little gun repair business going out of my garage. And so I get to see everybody, talk to them about what they're doing and what's going on and stuff. And it's kind of kept me involved in that without doing something that makes my back worse. So these are ways that they're cognitive adjustments in how I see myself able to fulfill these roles that are important to me. That's the language I'm using, role function. I find role functioning to be a useful perspective that the reason why people do things that are unhealthy are often because that's what I have to do to be a good parent, that's what I have to do to be a good spouse, that's what I have to do or else I won't see my friends, that's my hobby. My father developed a back problem and he likes to play golf. And he might have lost the ability to play golf. And that was not a small thing. Because that was his social and leisure outlet. And you say you can't play golf anymore, and now he's just sitting around the house and watching TV. I mean, you know, that would have been a loss for him. Thankfully, he was able to get back to it. But, you know, we all have our social and occupational and family roles, also religious, spiritual, existential, what's my purpose in life. I mean, we'll get to that a little bit more, but I think you can always ask people, what's the difference in what you were doing before you had the pain condition and what you're doing now? How has your life changed? And is this is independent of the pain? And I say, oh, let me tell you. And they'll tell you, you know, you'll need to have 5 or 10 minutes for that because they have a lot to say about how their life has changed. So coping skills, stress management, and personal skills. A lot of times it's helpful to have the spouse in because sometimes the person will say, well, this is what I need to do. And the spouse will say, no, you don't. So the spouse will say, we'd much rather you take care of yourself physically and do these other things than do what you've been doing and then be in bed for 3 days. And so sometimes if everybody can get on the same page about what the plan is from today forward, or at least let's try this from today forward, very often that has a big impact on them physically because it's impacting their judgment and decision making on whether they do something that has an adverse impact. Or if the spouse knows, well, if they do these things, it'll have a positive impact. If they have these things, it'll have a negative impact. Now the spouse is saying, look, we want you to do the things that work because we don't like you when you don't do those things. We don't like you when you do the things that make you worse. So this is something the three of us have in common. We all want you to get better. The treatment provider, the patient, and the spouse all want the patient to get better. So, if the three of us can sit in a room and focus on that, that usually results in a positive change. And again, if you communicate with the other treatment providers, have you been to a physical therapist? Have they told you what they want you to do more of and do less of? Are you doing it? So again, you don't have to be the physical therapist, but you can ask about compliance. Are you taking medication as prescribed? Are you having a problem with medication? Did you talk to the person who prescribed it? So again, you're not doing the medication, because it has to do with treatment compliance and treatment resistance, you're a much better expert at
say whatever I want to, and my family's sick of hearing me talking about this. They don't want to hear it. So usually their need to talk is more than their support system's ability to listen. And it's like a sick child, where if your child is sick, that hurts you as much as them. Well, everybody that cares about them, it's frustrating when somebody you care about is suffering and there's nothing you can do but watch them suffer. So sometimes they're trying to hide it from their family because they don't want their family to worry. So once again, you see the place of the psychosocial treatment as some place where they can say whatever's on their mind, that's missing for most of them. Yes?
Dr. Blattner, do you find that when all these treatment modalities are working in harmony with one another, as the patient regains some sense of empowerment with these different treatment modalities, that their medication usage, whether it's non-opiate or whatever, decreases?
Oh, yeah. Well,
okay. Is that like an ultimate goal, or is it just status quo?
I say that my goal is to have the person in a healthier state physically as well as emotionally. And we want to minimize their suffering and maximize their functioning physically as well as emotionally.
It's a quality of life.
You know, it all depends on the patient population you get. The patient population that I get, they're usually on a lot of, you know, we don't get anybody on no medicine. We get people on a lot of medicines. So the first thing I feel like I need to do is straighten that out, get the stuff that's the wrong stuff out of there, make sure we use non-habit forms of medicine appropriately so that the transition has a minimum of discomfort, and that it facilitates their ability to do the other things. And then, just as you're saying, the more they're able to do the psychosocial and the physical treatments, the need for medication starts going down. Anybody who's on a long-term medication, I always mandate a trial decrease every 6 months to a year. And if they get worse, I'll go right back up on it and leave it there.
Even
if they get better?
Even an antidepressant?
Yeah. Small, and I'm talking about a small step down. So you've been on this antidepressant for 3 years? I'm going to suggest, at some point, this is not an emergency, at some point, I'm going to suggest that we try a small step down in the dose and see what happens. Because you may not need the same dose today as you needed 3 years ago. And sure enough, a lot of them feel better on less, and they're pleasantly surprised. So it's all about benefits and side effects, matching what you need now, which might not be the same thing that you needed before. Yes?
Is there any truth, I heard this a while ago, that with chronic depression, that if you come off for a while and go back on medication, that can be worse than staying on medication for a long time?
Well, so is it bad to come off or go back on it? I just want to be clear, I didn't recommend coming off of anything. I recommend a small step down as a trial, see what happens. Now, I think a better way to say what you just said, or the more appropriate focus, is if a mood disorder, if you get symptoms into remission, and then the symptoms recur, that's bad. But if you're able to decrease the medication and not have the symptoms recur, that's fine. So it's all about how they're doing. And it's all about matching whatever they're taking to what they need to feel better and function better, to be better able to participate in the psychosocial treatment, to be better able to do the healthy things physically. So while I'm adjusting the medication, I'm saying, well, how are you doing in those other areas?
Right.
Because if you're not making progress or you're getting worse, I'm going to want to make sure the medicine is not part of the problem.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, let's say someone gets down to
medicine's not part of the problem. Okay. So, some more losses. I think you get that. I think it's something that doesn't get enough attention in these places, in these patients, in terms of how has your life changed. Another way you can look at it is what's the difference between where you are now and where you expected to be. So it'll be, you know, yeah, I figured I'd be doing this and this, and then this would happen, and I'm retired, we travel, or you know, whatever it is. And they say, now I'm here, and those things I envisioned for the future are not going to happen. The question's been asked, why does a woman or a family mourn the loss of a miscarriage? After all, they didn't know the baby. And the reason is because a whole set of expectations has been constructed. That you don't just mourn what you knew, you also mourn the future you envision. So we've been talking about baby furniture, getting the baby's room ready. There's a whole... So again, for these patients, it's not only what they've lost from the past, but their vision of the future that is not going to happen.
Unresolved grief.
Yeah, yep. Exactly.
Yep.
Exactly. Existential or spiritual. So these are the two questions that come up the most often. Well, if I'm not able to do physically what I used to, I don't want to just depend on people. I mean, look, I'm just a burden to my family. Why am I even here? You know, before they had a pain condition, they knew why they were here. They knew what their purpose was. They knew, you know, this is who I am. This is what I do. I provide for my family. I do my work. This is what I do for fun. For the religious and spiritual, some people, we were just talking about this, some people have an idea, may not even realize they have the idea that, well, if I... You know, if I raise my family in the right way, if I go to church once a week, if I do what I'm supposed to do, I don't do what I'm not supposed to do, and I live a good life, I'm not perfect. So why did this happen to me? In other words, this is not supposed to happen to me. I'm doing all these things. Sometimes it's, why did God do this to me? Am I being punished? And... that's a real spiritual crisis. It gets, you know, it kind of interfaces a little bit with what's my purpose in life, but it's a different thing when people have had this faith. And I was saying earlier, the best answer to it that I've come across, and I'm certainly not an expert in this area, but Kushner's book, When Bad Things Happen to Good People, and his daughter got, his five-year-old daughter got leukemia and died. So that was a spiritual crisis for him. How can this, you know, how can God let this happen? The conclusion he came to was that the cancer genes didn't know the difference between the good people and the bad people. And the role of religion and spirituality and faith was, now what do I do? How do I get through this? How do I go forward? Now what?
Yeah.
And that's the, you know, that's the best I've come up with in terms of how to address that. But just the idea that another thing Kushner says is God is not a vending machine. So you know, you go to the vending machine, you put your coins in, you push a button, and the thing comes out. You don't get to say, look, I went to church every week, so nothing's bad supposed to happen to me. I'm not supposed to get injured. I'm not supposed to get a pain condition. I'm not supposed to get cancer. That's not supposed to happen because I did all these things I'm supposed to do. It just doesn't work that way. Yes?
Okay, so just a quote I heard once that I thought was really great was, you know, your faith or your spirituality isn't an insurance that nothing bad will happen, but it's assurance when it does.
Thank you for that. Yes.
And then I was an engineering student, undergraduate. We took thermodynamics, and it talked about randomness. And the universe is random. You can't always predict.
try to apply that paradigm to pain. You have a pain. I have a pill. You take this pill and it doesn't work quite as well. You have a pain. I have a procedure. You get this procedure and it doesn't work. So people have been frustrated. So the paradigm that works is coronary artery disease. What causes heart disease? Well, you have to check cholesterol, you have to check triglycerides, you have to check blood pressure, you have to check heart rhythm. Genetics plays a role. So what do? Well, we look for all these different factors in each person, and then whatever combination we find, we treat that combination. So, similarly, and mental health providers understand this, let's look at all the potential things that could be contributing to this. And then, for this individual, let's make sure that each factor that's a contributor gets addressed. So I want to make sure you get treatment for the stuff I don't do. But I want to help make sure that whatever the contributing factors are, that we at least assess for that, that we at least look for that. And obviously we can just apply that to the behavioral healthcare side, that some people have the religious and spiritual crisis. For other people, that's not an important thing to them. So if I want to find out if that's there or not, and if that's there, I want to help them address it. If it's not there, then, okay, well, what is it for you that's pouring gasoline on the fire? And then educational, just the idea that they understand what's going on. I've seen people that have had surgeries, and I've talked to them about what their MRI says, and they go, nobody ever talked to me about this. So having an understanding of what this is these days, most people get some education, you know, and they're looking for it if they're not getting it. But 10 years ago, 20 years ago, there were a lot of people walking around who really didn't understand what they were dealing with. So what I've listed here is some of our session topics in our pain recovery program. So the components of what folks need on the psychotherapy or the group front, one is there is a place for an educational component about how each factor impacts or potentially impacts the pain condition. The second thing is cognitive behavioral therapy to vent and to adjust role expectations. How does your life affect your pain, and how does your pain affect your life? And then learning behavioral techniques to pour water on the fire and turn down the volume. So why do this? Sort of a little bit of the seven habits of highly effective people, why be proactive. And so understanding the potential rewards of trying something different. Yeah, in the spirit of one step at a time, I don't tell them you have to do this for the rest of your life. I just say, are you willing to try something different and see what happens? You can always go back to the old way. But so we're not talking about changing the rest of your life. We're talking about trying something different. Helping them to look at their priorities and goals, which of course are individualized. What are their healthy habits and routines, and what are their unhealthy habits, and how can they be gradually changed? Recognizing, managing emotions, and somehow learning to modulate them, understanding something about the effects of emotions on physical pain, separating emotions from actions. Obviously, we have a lot of impulsivity that folks get into. I do this because it makes me feel better. I avoid doing that because it makes me feel worse. Just because you feel angry doesn't mean that you have to do the thing that you've been doing if that's not working. So we can talk about their emotions in reaction to their pain and their behavior, their judgment and decision making, of what they're deciding to do and what impact that's having. group, this is my family, this is my work. And for most of these folks, everything's going along fine, and then the pain condition comes along, and what they're doing is they're making decisions and they're behaving according to their belief system. So if they say, well, this is what a man is supposed to do, this is what a mother is supposed to do, and I'm not able to do that, so sometimes there's a conflict between their core beliefs and their new physical limitations. And so, once again, that is often the motivator for doing the things that aren't working. Coping skills, impact on role functioning, impact on family, healthy ways to express thoughts and emotions. So again, all these are familiar to you. All we're doing here is applying the things that you already know about and you already apply with your patients. We're applying that to a particular group. I sort of think of it as it's an anxiety and depression group that's focused on a special patient population. But what you're doing is the same stuff you would do for anxiety and depression without pain. Communication, attitudes, perspectives. So what's the silver lining to the dark cloud? I can't versus I choose not to. So I had an iron worker who used to pride himself on having one of the nicest yards in the neighborhood. And the only problem was it was a school a block or two away, so the kids would, on their way to school, drop trash in his lawn. So after he got injured, every day he would go outside, bend over, pick up the trash, make his back worse, go inside, and then be in pain for an hour or two, and angry and irritated. So one day he comes in, and I go, how are you doing? He says, I'm doing great. And I said, oh, what, you know, I'm looking, we haven't changed anything in a while. I said, well, what happened? He said, well, you know, and he told me the story about the pride in the yard and stuff. And then he said, you know, the other day I went out there and I just stood there. Stood there for about 5 minutes, looked at the trash on the lawn, turned around, went back in and said, I'm not doing it. It's not worth it. I'm not going to do these things that make my pain worse anymore. So he has something which was a sort of a role for him, you might say, and he made a decision that this is not worth making my pain worse. And it turned out he was making 100 decisions like that every day. And once he decided, I'm tired of this, he adjusted his lifestyle and he just started getting better. So just the idea of you don't have to do these things that you're doing. And all I'm suggesting is that you ask yourself, is this really worth it? Is this really what you want to do? You know, option A, option B, pluses and minuses to option A, pluses and minuses to option B, you know, you want to try something different for a while. And so the idea that they're making a choice as opposed to, I have to do this, that could be something that can make a difference. Goals, progressive muscle relaxation, do no harm, nutrition, healthy sleep is a big deal. If they're not sleeping well, then their benefit is going to be limited. Got to get them having healthy sleep, and that's something I monitor. And I want to make sure that they're getting 6 to 8 hours and that it's not disrupted. Yes?
Question about sleep medications. You know, you use them here, and everything from melatonin, you know, to other stuff. And do any of those medications actually interfere with the best sleep you can get? Like, is melatonin maybe better because it's more natural?
The habit-forming medications can interfere with sleep. The so-called antidepressants, if
time sleep is one of the most stubborn things. I read one study, New England Journal of Medicine, alcoholics looked at their sleep architecture compared to alcoholics in recovery and people that didn't have a substance use problem. And couldn't tell the difference in the sleep EEGs between the people in recovery and people that had never had a substance use problem. The alcoholics, of course, had markedly abnormal. Then they followed alcoholics, this group who got into recovery. Their sleep architecture went back to normal and indistinguishable from the others at 6 months. It took 6 months for their sleep architecture to normalize. Now, this is in the brainstem. I mean, this is a deep core brain function. It's completely involuntary. So it just says something about, I think, in general, that as these substances wash out of the system, it's not just 7 days detox. It really, there are gradual changes that continue for many months. So that's just a comment about, in our population, sometimes it's almost routine that people need something to help out, something not happening.
And when you say sleep architecture, are you talking about the levels of sleep and REM?
Yeah, there are these stages, and REM sleep, which is the dream state, tends to be drastically decreased for people who have major depression and also for people who have a substance problem.
So that would say that's on the minimum side of returning to more normal brain function? Because some people say, I can't tell if a person is depressed until they've been off alcohol for a year. Because it's the central nervous system depressing. So 6 months? I say 2 years.
I would just say this. I think what we wind up doing in the real world is most of us, prescribers, is we treat symptoms when they're there. And I think the importance of the point that you're bringing up is we need to try medication decreases because they may not need something 6 months down the road that today they feel awful if they don't have it. So, and it also gets back to the point you were raising about, do they need medicine less? It's important to reassess that periodically. And just the idea that, as you're saying, there are changes that continue. They tend to be more subtle as you get farther out, but the longer people are in recovery, they'll say, oh yeah, the 6 month was different than the 5th month. And, oh yeah, a year was different than 6 months. I could tell the difference.
2 years.
Sorry.
Yeah, I was just curious about when you're looking at sleep architecture, if you look at other potential interfering factors such as diet, chemical stimulation like caffeine, sugar, visual stimulation like, you know, screen time and
that kind of stuff. I mean, I think one of the things is I make sure people get a good multivitamin. And if they're, particularly if they're alcohol, is their substance that they get a good B complex? I think it's a healthy thing to do anyway if they don't have a substance problem, but if they do, I think they've usually been depleted of nutrients. Otherwise, we just want to promote a healthy diet, like for anybody else. And just Andrew Weil, Dr. Weil.com, he has the anti-inflammatory diet. And again, this is, you know, like a heart healthy diet, it's not a secret what it is. We advocate that, you know, if it can make a difference, it's, you know, we don't expect people to bat 1,000, but you should just know.
Christian advisor that she needed somebody, she needed to find somebody to love her, like Jesus would love her?
Yes. Well, but mainly was to relieve her of her guilt of thinking that she wasn't doing enough, you know, to earn God's love and all that.
A lot of guilt shame. I think part of it is people are looking for an explanation.
Yeah.
They want to know, why is this happening?
Yeah, why is this happening?
And I think from the upbringing that a lot of people have had is, well, if this is happening, you must have done something.
That's right. Like Job.
You know, maybe you didn't do something you were supposed to do, or you did something you weren't supposed to do. But somehow, if you do what you're supposed to do, then things go okay. If you don't do what you're not supposed to do, you'll be okay. But if something's happening,
then you must have some secret sin that you're being punished for. So anyway, we talked, and she said, well, you know, I just feel, you know, relieved that that I was not thinking correctly. But as I said, I said, well, these people, your friends, quote unquote, you know, that laid all this stuff on you, I said, they're not really helping you.
Well, and I think also there's not every, you know, there may be some people who see God in that way, or who say they do.
Yeah.
But not everybody sees God in that way.
Right.
And as you said, you know, you can read in the Bible that it didn't work that way.
I mentioned Kushner's book about why do bad things happen to good people. And the randomness of life, there are no guarantees for any of us, and so forth and so forth. And of course, like with me, I've been a pastor for 50 years, and a therapist and so forth, and I had artery bypass surgery a couple of years ago. And I'm not able to do what I would like to do, you know, physically anymore. So, well, do you think this is God's will for me, you know, for all these years of service? I would expect more. And so she laughed, and she said, well, yeah, you're a walking parable, you know. I said, well, the Lord isn't finished with me yet. There's some things I still can do. But anyway, just don't beat yourself up so much.
Yeah.
That's the
good news. This is my last slide. And I think there are patients who come to our offices where when we see them, the name on the calendar, can we pump that patient back a week? Can we go to once a month instead of once a week, or once every 3 months if we're only doing once a month? Everybody I know in healthcare, at least the people I hang around with, are compassionate, respectful, and they do good care. But when we get these challenging and frustrated patients, sometimes that can pull us off the mark. And these, so the people are going through a lot of suffering for a long time. It can be extra difficult to, you know, one of the things I'll say is, you know, from everything you've told me and from everything I've learned about reading your chart, it sounds like you've been through a lot of suffering for a long time. I don't blame you for wanting relief from your suffering. And what I'm here to do is to try to do what I can to offer you something that can work better for you than what you've been doing. But I don't blame you for your suffering. And you turn to a substance because it was there. And what you've learned is that wasn't working for you. It might have worked in the short term, but time went on and the benefits went down and the side effects went up. So it is your responsibility. try something different. Just like the diabetic doesn't get to sit home and eat whatever they want to and not take care of themselves and say, well, I have diabetes, I can't help it. It's like, no, you need to, that there is a part of this that, and this is the disease model has been, I think, controversial because of this, because when a person has a disease, it's not their fault. And so there are a lot of people who don't like, they say they don't believe in the disease model because they think that removes from them the responsibility of what they need to do from today forward to get better. And so you can't just say, I'm an addict, I can't help it, it's a disease, there's nothing I can do. It's like, well, okay, you have a disease, you have your experience, it is your responsibility to start doing what works and to start making some changes because of the adverse effect this is having on you and the people you care about and the people who care about you. Yes?
Well, I was going to say, in any disease, you have responsibility to do things. You know, you're not going to say, well, I have cancer, so I'm going to sit home and die.
Yeah.
We have to go and seek out what do I need to do.
Yeah. So again, I try to maintain I have no doubt you're going through a lot of suffering. I understand this is not easy. And I understand you want relief from your suffering. And I'm not criticizing you for that. And sometimes with that foundation, they will, attitude-wise, they'll come around at some point. And that's partly how we kind of convert people from having adversarial and treatment-resistant attitudes in the beginning. Once they start feeling better some, and we maintain the compassion, and we don't get angry at them, we don't get in power struggles with them, we don't criticize them, we just try to focus on compassion and respect. Yes, you can make whatever choice you want to. You want to sign yourself out? Okay, what are you going to do? What's your plan? You know, just, okay, it's your choice, and you know, I'll say to people, I think you have the opportunity to try something different here. This place has worked for a lot of people. And once you leave here, that opportunity is over. So my suggestion is to just think very carefully that you get what you want to from this place before you leave, because it's an opportunity that's going to be gone. And that, for a lot of people, they start thinking about it, and they say, okay, yeah, I am ready to try something different. But it's really hard sometimes to hang on to the compassion and respect when these patients can be so difficult at times. So,
Dr. Blunder?
Yes?
I just have a comment. I hear out in the community when I'm visiting offices and talking with people, even from people in the helping profession, you know, people with degrees and licenses and all that, still have the attitude that unless the person wants help, they're wasting their time trying to get them here. And I just like you to talk, I mean, you just gave a good example of, you know, sometimes someone comes here when there's an external motivator, like an attorney representing them and their second DUI, and they really need to go somewhere, or a judge is going to put them in jail. That's okay. Because a light bulb can go off once they get here and they have an interaction with someone like you and other staff members. So, I don't know if you want to expand on that.
I would suggest a little different model. The model that I like is seed planting. It's like with kids and adolescents. My residency training director said, I'm going to make sure my kids got a lot of training in religion so that they can reject it in their teens and 20s and come back to it in their 30s. The idea that I'm going to let people know I'm concerned about them from everything they've said, my concern is that if they go in this direction, it's not going to go well. And if they're willing to give this other thing a try, I think they might be surprised about the benefits. We have people come in all the time and say, yeah, I didn't listen to them, but deep down I knew they were right, and I never forgot what that person told me 5 years ago. And now I've been in recovery for a year. But I had while. And so, yeah, I guess another thing I learned as a sort of a rookie therapist was we have to judge ourselves not on how our patients are doing, but on did I do a good job with what was in front of me? And so my focus is am I providing the right type of compassion, respect, support, intervening in what way that I can, given the situation in front of me? And if that person decides to do something that I think is the wrong thing to do, I know I did what I was supposed to do. I did what I could. And with the idea that it's not all just if they don't do what I say, then I fail.
It's not the silver bullet.
I have planted a seed.
Yeah, right.
And where I can plant seeds do my job to listen and understand as much as I can, and then offer options, advocate appropriately, then hopefully sooner or later they'll come around. And that's what we see. We see people come back, you know, most people don't come back a second time, but we see people who come back a second time or whatever, and they go, yeah, what they told me was right. I thought maybe I could go back to using and not get the downside of that. And they told me this was going to happen, and then it happened. So we understand that's part of the process for some people, that, you know, they've got to do it their way. But if we've done good work, then ultimately people usually come around.
Yeah. So biblical example of that, where it says some plant the seed, some water, some see the harvest. You might be all three at some time, sometimes you only get one part of it.
We do what we can.
I was just going to have our staff who are actually here today, there are a few of them, if they would raise their hands so our guests know who you are. That would be lovely, over there, on that side, and here. Yeah, thank you. We also have an alumni of our program in here, but I will not embarrass her by having her wave her hand, but I'm really glad she's here. I'm an open book. Oh.
Go ahead, embarrass her.
That was her, that's her, up to her.
No embarrassment here.
St. John's County is this little radio station. It's amazing, called WSOS. And I go once a week and I take either a staff member with me or an alumni. A lot of times it's an alumni. And Melanie went with me yesterday and did a wonderful job. So she sort of told her story to the listeners. You know, the drive time in St. Augustine with this radio station is 13 and a half minutes. So we try to like get their attention for 13 and a half minutes. And she just was amazing, trying to reach out to people who might be family members or coworkers or friends of someone. You know, that's sort of the audience we try to appeal to, and she's wonderful. So, thank you. All right.